the wedding song, klezmer style. Welcome once again to the Radical Imagination. I'm your host, Jim Vrettos. I'm a sociologist who's taught at John Jay College and Yeshiva University here in New York. As the Israel-Palestine conflict and its intractable and agonizing debate goes on, true peace in the region seems further away than ever. Particularly in American political, progressive, and leftist circles, the discourse on Palestine is said to be shifting. One could look at Michelle Alexander's recent New York Times op-ed piece, Time to Break the Silence on Palestine, or Angela Davis speaking out on Palestinian rights, the boycott, divestment, sanctions movement. Other examples are professor and CNN commentator Mark Lamont Hills calling for a free Palestine from the river to the sea, and Michigan Representative Rashida Tlaib's vision of a greater Palestine, a single binational state that would be neither Jewish nor Zionist. It seems fairly obvious that there's a growing questioning by progressives of Israeli policies, aspects of the Zionist ideology that underpin it, and even a questioning of its basic right to exist as a state. Now, all of this has to be confusing to the average observer trying to understand the nuances of the struggle and debate. Many progressive critics of the Jewish state insist that being anti-Zionist isn't the same as being anti-Semitic. Yet drawing the line can be difficult, as it was during the Women's March this year, which was roiled by accusations of anti-Semitism as leaders, among other statements, referred to avowed anti-Semite Louis Farrakhan as the greatest of all time. In another case, Minnesota Representative Ilhan Omar apologized for her anti-Semitic tropes, saying it's all about the Benjamin's baby, suggesting that Israel's allies in American politics were motivated by money rather than policies and morality. While many of Israel's progressive critics do understand that the Israel-Palestinian conflict is far more complicated than the black and white picture they sometimes draw, the radical left's militant hostility toward the Jewish state and aspects of its Zionist vision has been true for decades. Certainly, some of the criticism of Israel is anti-Semitic, but it's entirely possible to oppose Jewish ethno-nationalism without being a bigot, particularly given the way the current Israeli government has aligned itself with far-right European movements in Hungary, for example, that have anti-Semitic roots, hostile to Jews themselves. Israel's growing ties with repressive regimes like Saudi Arabia, in alliance with America, cries out for scrutiny concerning the unique role that America has played, and still does play, of course, as Israel's protector. The vast majority of American Jewry should have little difficulty agreeing that their Jewish ethics would demand that scrutiny. What many in the American Jewish and non-Jewish community are not aware of is the long history of a movement of strictly Orthodox Jews who have been consistent and strong supporters in solidarity with the Palestinian struggle and their rights and freedom, and opponents of what they see as Israeli colonialism from the United States to Jerusalem and Gaza. These are the ultra-Orthodox anti-Zionist rabbis of Nuturi Karta, and they are the subject of a brilliant new documentary by a courageous female filmmaker who has pushed boundaries both in her work and in her life. She grew up in a modern Orthodox Jewish Zionist community, left it for a non-religious life in New York, and has become an ardent activist for Palestinian freedom. We're deeply honored and thrilled to have the creator and director of the forthcoming film, The Rabbis Intifada, on the Radical Imagination to help us clarify a rich and complicated narrative. So welcome Heather Tenzer to the Radical Imagination.
Thank
it's
you.
Great to have you here.
Thank you, great to be here.
This is such a fascinating topic, subject. Tell us a little about your own background, how you got involved in this creation of this film.
Sure. Well, as you mentioned, I grew up in a modern Orthodox Jewish community.
In New Jersey?
In New Jersey.
New Jersey, okay.
And we marched in the Israel Day Parade in New York City to support Israel growing up in right. religious school. And
which you attended.
Which I attended. Okay. And so that was my introduction to Naturae Carta, because Naturae Carta, the rabbis of Naturae Carta were standing on the sidelines of the parade and protesting the parade in which we were marching.
The other side of Fifth Avenue, where the supporters of Israel were standing, right? So the other side, there was settled aside. By the way, I was on that side too with mm-hmm. Tikkun, the mm-hmm. Tikkun group, which was, so I know what you're saying. It's an interesting way they try to divide people up. And I took a turn going across Fifth Avenue as well to meet with them too. But anyway, I'll go on with your, sorry. So you were at the parade there and.
And that was my introduction to seeing Jews, much less religious Jews, standing in opposition to Israel and in support of the Palestinian struggle. That was my the first time that I knew that any Jews supported
Even
Palestine or opposed Israel.
How did you feel about that?
I felt confused.
How old were you?
I was a young teenager, maybe 13, 14 years old. Yeah. So.
And people are yelling at them, right? And
there's people yelling at them.
Why are you doing this? You're traitors.
Right, right. Exactly.
You're confused, though. All right.
I was confused and probably a little bit fearful. all sorts of emotions. Just
sure.
Yeah. I shock, bet. Surprise. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that was my introduction to the group of rabbis who I ended up filming and making a documentary about more than 20 years later. So
now, but now you still have this movement away from modern Orthodoxy and what moving to New York as a young woman in your late teens, 20s, college?
Or? Yeah, I went to college and moved around for a little bit and have spent most of my adult life living in New York City. I also spent some time living in Jerusalem,
Was there any reason mm-hmm. that you sort of gave up the modern Orthodox background that you had? I mean, was it just sort of a gradual falling out or abrupt realization that wasn't for you, or how did that happen?
It wasn't an extreme moment of. It's just not where I am right now in my religious life, but I have no judgments against
Animus
other people who are Orthodox. It's just not what I'm choosing, but yeah.
Right. So how would you identify yourself now and in, as you say, the last 20 years and your movement toward making this incredible movie?
I think that the film really started when I started learning more about the Palestinian struggle and about learning more about Israel from a different perspective than the one that I was raised with. I spent time living in Jerusalem, as I mentioned, traveling in the West Bank and Gaza, and learning, meeting a lot of Palestinians, hearing a different perspective.
When was this? What year mm-hmm. are we talking about?
I would say, I started learning about the situation probably in around 2000.
So mm-hmm. you again, just tell us, you were going around and you were just what, startled at the conditions, or what made you get so interested?
Filming and it was.
Oh, you're filming at that point?
I was filming at that point, not
I
for
see.
This film, but I was filming and it was my first exposure to hearing Palestinians talk about the oppression and violence that they face every day at the hands of Israelis. I hadn't heard that before. I hadn't been exposed to that perspective. And just seeing with my own eyes the ways that Israel was brutalizing Palestinians.
What did you see? What were some of the things you saw?
I saw tanks with their gunships pointed at mothers carrying their babies over past a checkpoint. Just trying to get home. I saw a child who was about maybe 13 years old who was walking with crutches and very depressed because he had he was living in Hebron, and he had been shot in the leg by Israeli settlers. And so these are just, I saw a water crisis that was ongoing in which Palestinians had to be very, had very careful because they had very little access to water Israeli Water Authority would turn on and off their water without really giving much thought to how it was affecting the daily life of Palestinians, or maybe they did.
Did you talk to fellow Israelis about this? What were they thinking about this? You were in Jerusalem, you say?
Right. And traveled through the West Bank and Gaza.
And Gaza too at that
point. Yeah, so I met all different kinds of Israelis. And
from all backgrounds and political spectrums, religious and
so
on?
Right,
right. All right.
Found myself learning from Israelis who were critical of what their own country was doing to Palestinians, with the violence, with the separation walls, with roads that were Jewish-only roads, settlements inside the West Bank that are Jewish-only settlements, different ways of making just daily life very difficult, unpleasant for Palestinians.
You were very moved. I mean, this was a heartfelt, this is wrong. This is not how you were trained, and it's not what Jews should be doing to
exactly.
other people, right?
Not part of the Jewish values.
Tradition
that
and so on.
That I was raised with, surely.
But you certainly weren't oblivious to the struggles in the past wars and the hate and contempt that has developed on both sides. I mean, did you in fact feel there was, how did you feel about what, you know, the Israeli side there? You were talking to peace advocates, right?
I was. Mm-hmm.
So, but you, at that point, if I can, do you still believe, or did you believe then, that Israel had a right to exist, or when were you moving toward what, in your terms of your own viewpoint of Zionism?
I started to meet people who were critical of not just Israeli violence, but started learning more about Israel's founding, and that was the critical piece, really.
Tell us a little more for our audience, so we understand what that means, what Zionism is, and so on.
Israel was founded in 1948, and it was
as a state now, as a modern political state.
As a state.
As an entity.
And in order for that founding to take place, Israel massacred and expelled thousands of Palestinians from their homeland where they had been living for hundreds of years.
Okay.
That's the part of the history that I think was missing from my American Jewish education. Yeah.
But there was also an attack on Israel from the second that it was declared a state.
Mm-hmm.
So did you bring that into your understanding? I mean, there was hard feelings on both sides, right?
There are two sides to it. I guess what I'm saying is that, or what Palestinians are saying is that they had been living there peacefully, and actually also what the rabbis in my film are saying is that the Palestinians had been living in Palestine peacefully alongside of their Jewish neighbors for many years.
Right.
There was a small Orthodox Jewish community living in Jerusalem who had been living in coexistence with Muslim and Christian Palestinians, and the Jews themselves identified as Palestinian Jews. What happened was that Zionism was a movement that grew up in Europe, thousands of miles away from
19th century.
In the 1880s.
Yes, 1880s, right.
Right.
But again, a little bit, and we want to get to your fabulous movie in a few minutes, but to get some background on this, I mean, again, biblical, there was an ancient Israel, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So, and then you know the history better than I do on this. So there's the destruction of the temple mm-hmm. and the end of that state, and mm-hmm. then the diaspora mm-hmm. and the hungering for some sort of entity that would protect our, you know, next year in Jerusalem, for example. So although there was a couple thousand years of wandering and so on, it wasn't that many Jews wouldn't want to go back to the Holy Land. They just weren't able to, or how would you put it? I mean, there was a national entity in this sense. There was a state of Israel.
There was no state of Israel until...
Well, not a state, but there was an ancient Israel, right? In
well,
the Bible?
There's a land that...
A land that was called Israel. No?
I mean, there was, in ancient times, there was a
in
land.
In ancient,
okay, yes.
Okay. All right. So we just want to get the history straight because...
Actually, I think it was called Canaan, right?
Okay, but there's mentioned to...
Right,
the ancient Israelites.
Right.
All right. So mm-hmm. there was some connection to the modern political state and those biblical references. But yeah. you're right. Let's not spend 2,000 years. All right. So the political state comes about, mm-hmm. and the unfairness of it strikes you as the Palestinians get to be what? Becoming the victims of that state, and again, I guess we're bypassing the whole period of the Holocaust, which gave some push toward
mm-hmm.
needing that state for protection.
But. Right. Well, but yes, but Zionism was growing up in the 1880s in Europe, and so Jewish Zionists from Europe decided that because of the violence that they were facing in Europe, there was a movement to create a Jewish state in Palestine.
Right.
And there's the famous expression of Golda Meir, a land for a people without a land. Yes, thank you. And of course, there were many people already living on that land. They were both Jewish Palestinians, Christian Palestinians, and Muslim Palestinians, and they were all living there peacefully until the Zionists started to arrive and created a movement, a political movement, to create a Jewish national homeland in Palestine.
Okay.
This was the tension that the Orthodox Jews in Jerusalem were experiencing in the 1920s as immigrants from Europe started coming and trying to create a political agenda. They had a political agenda to create a national homeland in Palestine.
And the group of rabbis that you are depicting in your film rejected the idea, the notion that Zionism should exist, that if there was going to be a Jewish state, it should be brought about through God's will or Messiah, is that
right? Well, for Orthodox Jews and for most Jews, for thousands of years, like the idea of a national Jewish a Jewish nation state was really an anathema to Judaism, and for thousands of years, Jews rejected the idea of creating some sort of Jewish national homeland, and this idea of Zionism was relatively new and an anathema to most Orthodox rabbis at the time, not just Naturei Karta, but really a huge swath of Orthodox Jews.
Okay.
And not only Orthodox Jews, but also to many secular Jews, to socialist and communist Jews who were also living in Europe at the time.
So we're going to play a couple of clips soon here about Naturei Karta and feelings about that group of rabbis. Mm. So this is a clip by, I believe, a figure in Israel talking about them as they're depicted in Israel.
Naturei Karta are being called by Israel and by pro-Israeli communities, especially in the United States, as traitors. And I can relate to it because I'm also called a traitor in Israel. I think most of the Israelis perceive Naturei Karta as aliens, as people who represent exile, represent the old Jewish life that Zionism wanted to leave behind. I think Neturei Karta has some ideological meeting points with progressive Jews around the world, especially those who would define themselves as anti-Zionists. In some of the demonstrations around the world, you can see anti-Zionist progressive Jews, Palestinians, and Neturei Karta demonstrating together.
State of Israel does not represent world Jewry, so so their role in this is to do what? What are they attempting to do here in their opposition to the state? And how many people are we talking about here? And many still do live in Israel, right? Mm-hmm. And they live in Williamsburg, right? Mm-hmm. Upstate. Mm-hmm. So
Neturei Karta is a community that was founded in Jerusalem in the 1930s. And they, the meaning of the name is, it's an Aramaic term, and it means the guardians of the city. And so the city that they were guarding at the time was the city of Jerusalem. And what they were guarding against was the onslaught of Zionism, of this political endeavor to create a Jewish state in their midst. They had been living in the city of Jerusalem for hundreds of years, for generations, and they felt that they were being attacked by Jews who were coming from Europe and trying to create a nation state where they were living,
right.
Mm-hmm, a Jewish nation state. And now for them, and for Neturei Karta, they were Orthodox Jews, and as I said at the time, many Orthodox Jews refused the idea of Zionism. They were opposed to it.
But some did, right? Some would consider themselves Zionists, Orthodox Zionists.
At a certain
point. Or modern Orthodoxy,
right.
Where I taught Yeshiva University and so on,
yeah.
Would be fervent proponents mm-hmm. of the state, yes?
Yes, there is certainly.
So there's a battle there between.
There is a battle there, but
among
I'm
the
just
Orthodox.
Explaining that historically,
yeah.
that has shifted. So that now, yes, there is this battle between Orthodox groups, some who are Zionists and some who are anti-Zionists. But in the early days of Zionism, nearly all Orthodox Jews, whether they were modern Orthodox or strictly Orthodox, all of them were opposed to Zionism. And
okay.
only over time has that ideology become more accepted by some Jews, many Jews.
Many Jews. Mm-hmm. Would you say the majority of Jews worldwide, secular or not?
I think that's a debatable point. It's a shifting thing that's happening right now. I mean, I think that in the United States right now, we see a large trend towards American Jews criticizing Zionism. And
especially among young people,
mm-hmm,
yes.
Mm-hmm.
We've had Jewish Voice for Peace on a couple of times. We're mm-hmm. going to have them on as well again. Here's actually a short clip, I think, from a spokesman of Jewish Voice for Peace
okay.
on this.
Thank you.
The Rabbis Intifada has really challenged me to interrogate my own biases against Neturei Karta and ultra-Orthodox movements more broadly within Judaism. There they are in Gaza with the Palestinians, building actual relationships with them and getting to know them. Part of what we want to be doing at JVP is cracking the monolith of all Jews support Israel. So I'm excited for the conversations that the Rabbis Intifada will generate about Jewish opposition to Zionism that's theologically and ethically rooted.
Okay, so Jewish Voice for Peace and other organizations representing so many young people now are addressing the state in a different way than we've heard in past decades.
Mm-hmm.
How does your film, and we want to play the trailer in just also a few minutes, mm-hmm. how does your film enter into this debate? Because this is something really powerful here, the connection mm-hmm. that they're making with the Palestinians as a people,
mm-hmm.
going beyond what so many other Jews are doing. Did you find that, I mean, they're really putting themselves on the line here in the Torah Carta, right?
Oh, yeah.
Definitely. And other organizations are not doing what they're doing here. So they are the real thing in that sense, whatever else you want to say about them. So actually, maybe this would be a good point maybe to put on the trailer and give us an idea of this film that you've been that you're working on, that you finished, and gives an idea of what the debate is about here. Here's a trailer to your film, The Rabbis Intifada.
Army, and I'm respect the country, the Holy Land, and you don't respect it, you know?
I don't respect it, and I have really pity for you.
So the first time I met Neturei Karta, I was a child marching with my yeshiva in the Israel Day Parade, and Neturei Karta were standing on the sidelines protesting.
Free Palestine! Free Palestine!
Our rabbis said they're crazy, meshuga, don't pay any attention to them. And for a long time I didn't. Today I'm on a quest to find out about these rabbis. I begin meeting them in Jerusalem, the birthplace of Neturei Karta.
אנחנו בארץ כמה דורות לפני קום המדינה.
Zionism hat sich herumgesetzt auf dem Kopf von den Palästinien. Wie hat sich herum sein Kopf in der Bearbeitung bereits rausgetrieben.
Under attack, Israel's Air Force unleashes devastation on the Gaza Strip.
In December of 2009, I left for Gaza with a group of Neturei Karta rabbis. It had been a year since Israel bombed and invaded.
When the Melchoma passed in Gaza, it is given Zair Vaituklich.
While the Jewish establishment in the world more and more identify with any Israeli policy, they are the voice who say no. Judaism does not mean occupation, oppression, etc.
We are a delegation of rabbis here from the US, Canada, and from Britain with one message.
He wants to ask a question.
Yeah, what's your question?
This one. Who are you? Yehuda. Why are you
here? I'm thinking that يهجم علينا كنا يهود من الصهيون من تبعون الصهيون اللي بخش علينا دبابات طيارات
All right, so it's coming soon. This is an ongoing work.
Yes.
Right, and we want to talk more about how people can come see what you're doing and having a discussion. It's going to be February 28th. We'll get. So, look, some cynics might say, well, look, they're meeting with the Palestinians and showing this great love. Is it more pragmatic relationship that just can't stand the Zionists and so anybody is going to be opposing them? Or are they truly reaching out at a deep human level here and trying to establish relationships?
That's a great question. The rabbis have many different reasons for both standing against Zionism and also standing with Palestinians. And I would say their motives are oftentimes come under question or and after having spent a lot of time with them, I've learned that they genuinely support the Palestinian struggle for ethically rooted reasons. That they cite like the most, they cite the Torah as
yeah,
and some very basic passages like love your brother like you like your love. Thank
you. That's the most quoted passage.
Love your brother as yourself.
Yeah. One should love the stranger, for you are a stranger in the strange land.
Right.
Now, secular, Orthodox, non-Zionist, Zionist, mm-hmm, Jews, you know, reflect on that and agree, mm-hmm, with that, or
right,
many do.
Right.
What are some of the theological,
right,
so rationales behind their,
mm, so
vehement anti-Zionism?
Right. So theologically, the rabbis say that there should not be a Jewish state until the coming of the Messiah, that the Jews were put into exile by God, and after the destruction of the second temple,
because they were
sinning,
right? And their sin was
violating God's commandments.
Not okay.
Mm-hmm. And
so as this punishment,
this
then,
punishment of exile,
going to exile. Okay,
right. And so they're not allowed to leave exile of their own force. As a part of that, they're not allowed to rise up against other nations
who might be oppressing them.
There's a difference.
Okay.
There's a difference.
All right.
So in other words, they believe that if somebody is actually hurting them or being violent towards them, they have the right to fight back, to defend themselves.
Okay.
But what they're saying is that there are passages in the Torah which state that Jews shall not rise up against other nations. In other words, the attempt of Jews to use violence against Palestinians is like a direct violation of the Torah in that
or
way.
Or any group, because now the connection, because of the penitence they were exhibiting, or the need for that as a result of the sinning, and only Messiah, mm-hmm, could bring about an end to the exile? How would we know that? I know I'm asking you impossible questions here. And how would we know that?
These are deep theological questions one has to perhaps be a rabbi to fully grasp. But I'll do my best to summarize.
You went to yeshiva. But secular stuff. Right. Okay. And how would we know that the Messiah is here or coming, and what would that mean?
Right. I mean, I think that there's differences amongst Jews and probably amongst Orthodox Jews as to what that might look like when the Messiah comes, but...
Or for Christians, for that matter, or anything.
Certainly. But the idea is that when the Messiah comes, there will be peace on earth, and Jews will be returned by God to the land of Israel, the biblical land of Israel. But okay, that
we
does
won't get
not,
all mystical here. How
but
they
that
get
does not,
okay.
That does not mean that is that Jews would, that Palestinians would be removed from the land,
right,
or
banished,
that there would be any violence. In fact, there would not. It would be a time of peace on earth, and therefore there would be no violent struggle to overtake the land of Israel or Palestine.
And no need for nation states?
And no need for nation states, exactly.
Anywhere in the world?
Exactly. There would be no nation states. We
okay.
would be living, right.
So the rabbis there are looking very idealistic, utopian,
mm-hmm,
looking for a world without boundaries,
mm-hmm,
without nationality, without religion, without ethnicity, or somehow everybody would be following the laws, the rules. Now, would Christians somehow have to follow? You know, we're getting into stuff we may not be able to answer.
I think it's probably beyond the scope of the film.
Of the yes, okay.
What exactly would
right.
Messianic times would look like?
Yes.
According to.
But it's a fascinating question, because, mm-hmm, these are universal concerns and, mm-hmm, people all around the world. So this is not just some little faction within Israel, mm-hmm, or this and that. People all over the world are trying to transform the world,
mm-hmm,
oftentimes with the idea that this is the way it should be done, and we need to purify the world, and we need to cleanse it, and we need to follow the laws and rules of gods that they define as worthy and so on. Mm-hmm. And we have clash because more violence has occurred because of conflict within religions and between religions. So how do we, how does that work itself out?
I mean,
and how are the rabbis trying to grapple with that?
I think that the rabbis are saying we have historically had good relationships with Muslims in the Middle East. As Jews, we've lived in the Middle East for centuries and have had good relationships with our Arab neighbors, whether they're Christian or Muslim. That relationship was not destroyed by religion or religious differences. That relationship of coexistence in the Middle East, in Palestine and elsewhere in the Middle East, was not destroyed by a difference of views about who is God or
right.
between Muslim and Jew and Christian. The reason for the destruction of the havoc that's been wreaked on relationships between Jews and Muslims and Arabs and Jews is because of a political nationalism. And that is what they're struggling against, is this Jewish attempt by Jews to create a Jewish nation state. And that nationalism, of course, is not unique only to Jews. There's nationalisms everywhere in the world. But this nationalism, this Jewish nationalism to create a Jewish nation state in Palestine was a cause of a break, a rift, in an ongoing relationship that had been quite peaceful.
That's a great distinction. I think that's a helpful one to make. We may not be able necessarily to agree with all of it, mm-hmm. but no, that's a very important distinction. So now you get into the whole area of colonialism mm-hmm. and Israel as a colonial client, if you will, of America. Mm-hmm. Now you're opening up another Pandora's box, aren't
mm-hmm.
you? Mm-hmm. Now that I've opened that up, so the identification, America as Israel's protector, do the rabbis, what do they feel about that? Are they opposing Israel, the American foreign policy, AIPAC, or how does that fit into their struggles?
In your introduction, you talked about the recent
shifting
events in the news,
yes.
Where Mark Lamont Hill spoke out, Ilhan Omar spoke out against AIPAC, and the rabbis have stood up and are actually speaking out in support of Ilhan Omar and Mark Lamont Hill and other
so-called progressive voices
in the United States who are taking a stand against Israel and its policies. So
which are not in of itself anti-Semitic, and we've made that, tried to make that point. Mm-hmm. To be critical of Israel as such, as a state, is not in a sense always anti-Semitic.
Right. I mean, that is the main point that the rabbis are making, is that there is a difference between being anti-Semitic and being anti-Israel. And the two very, very different things. One is being against a nationalism, and another is against the anti-Semitism is against is about being against Jews.
And do they understand that exists? They certainly don't deny the Holocaust, right?
Oh, no, of course.
No, okay. It does exist.
They're just distinguishing and saying that one is able to oppose Israel, oppose Israeli policies, even oppose the existence or the idea of a Jewish nation state, Israel,
right.
and its existence, and not be anti-Semitic. That
and
is
how
what
do
they
you oppose
saying.
Anti-Semitism? How do they?
How do
the rabbis say the world and Jews should oppose anti-Semitism? How do we change that reality?
Mm.
If you're not going to do it, let's say one of the justifications mm-hmm. for Israel, in part, is to be a place, a haven, mm-hmm. in a heartless world,
mm.
in a, if you will, a Gentile world that has wreaked havoc. So, you know, that's part of the justification.
Mm-hmm.
We've had enough, we're gonna be strong, mm-hmm. and da-da-da-da-da-da. So the reality is there is anti-Semitism in the world. And as I mentioned in my opening too, there's, of all things now, the Israeli government is identifying with some of the regimes
mm-hmm.
who've been very anti-Semitic. So that's a whole other can of worms. But what do the rabbis say now about Now, they've embraced at different times, right? They went to Yasser Arafat's funeral. They've met with Iranian leaders.
They actually, the Naturi Karta rabbis have been making efforts to be in relationship with Palestinians for decades now. Rabbi Meir Hirsch, who was a Naturi Karta, Rabbi Moshe Hirsch.
Weiss? Oh, okay.
Rabbi Moshe Hirsch of Jerusalem was served in
funeral,
the
right?
cabinet of Yasser Arafat
right.
As the Minister of Jewish Affairs. And that relationship was really the beginning of the Naturi Karta's work with Palestinians to really try to bridge the gap that existed. And so,
you can understand perhaps, right, the Israelis and others, whatever you may think of Arafat, at the same time, the killing of innocent Israeli babies, the hijacking of planes, the blowing up civilians. How do they reconcile that? How do Rabbi Weiss, Hirsch, how do you deal with that? It's real, right?
Mm-hmm.
And is that explained by still sin?
There is a Palestinian resistance movement to
right.
the ongoing Israeli occupation of Palestine.
That took violent forms.
Yes, yes.
To a certain extent under
yes.
Arafat's PLO, right?
Right. Well.
Well.
Right.
Okay.
I guess the point is. Or the point that I'm trying to make, and maybe we can come back to this,
sure.
is that Rabbi Moshe Hirsch, who was working in solidarity with Yasser Arafat and making efforts to try to bridge a gap between Palestinians and Israelis, or Palestinians and Jews, was then attacked by Israeli extremists who attacked him with acid and attempted to murder him. And he was then blinded by that violent act of an Israeli Jew.
Which certainly no one could condone, but the anger was directed at the rabbi for working
with a Palestinian.
And feeling that an accomplice to the violence that was being perpetrated against. So, violence begets violence here, right? And how do we stop that? And also, I guess they worked with Farrakhan too, right? In terms of trying to tone down some of his anti-Semitic rhetoric, or
I'm not aware of any relationship with Farrakhan.
Okay, but let's stick with Arafat and some of the Iranian leaders too, and attending the Holocaust conference.
Mm-hmm.
What was that about? In Tehran, I think it was 2006.
Mm-hmm.
Seven.
So in terms of the relationship with Arafat and your question about why they would be working with him and his there is a back and forth violence, but we have to look at we have to examine and explore the origins of the violence. And
don't you condemn it on both sides? If you're going to be really honest about it, it's wrong for any Israeli or Palestinian baby.
There's two players in the Middle East, but they're not equal players. There's one state, one is a state with an army who is occupying militarily land that is not, according to international law, their land. They have military forces going into raiding homes in the middle of the night, and children are being arrested, young children being arrested in Israeli jails.
With all due respect, Martin Luther King could make a similar argument and yet wouldn't resort to the violence. And Gandhi, I mean, so we're not talking about Martin Luther King or Gandhi
well,
here.
What
right?
would you do if your child was being arrested in the middle of the night by an Israeli soldier with a gun pointing at him?
Would you
not use violence in that case?
I mean, if you're asking me personally, no. And so, I've been involved.
Your child is being has a gun at his head?
I would protest. I would organize in a nonviolent way. I don't think that, first of all, going against a military strength like that is sort of suicidal. But I certainly wouldn't. I would resist.
But,
I would.
But how should a person resist? How should
think,
a, how should a nation?
I think you
how should a group of people who are being oppressed resist the violence? Right now, there's a nonviolent movement called Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions, and that movement is holding a lot of power right now and actually creating a lot of change. Right.
Okay, that's a nonviolent. There's also Women Wage Peace. I don't know if you're familiar with that movement. Palestinian and Israeli women. Women. Tens of thousands are marching and protesting the violence on both sides.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's, but.
But what, I mean, the question is like, what does one do when the situation is violent? It's not, should they turn their head?
I don't think we're saying that. I think,
right.
I don't think you, you know, but we've had this discussion a lot in this country. I've had Mark Rudd on, for example, who was, you know, one of the SDS leaders of Columbia uprising, and who turned to the Weathermen and advocated violence there, got involved, went underground, and so on. I know other people, Kathy Bodine, who was and we
I'm
see
not
where
here
that left.
I'm not here
no.
advocating violence, but
no,
what
I
am saying is that when you're in a no-win situation, there.
Why would you say no win?
Because there is a military force that is.
But isn't that the whole idea of civil disobedience and nonviolent protest and organizing and getting the moral support of the world and so on? I think otherwise it seems to me that we're turning to a tactic that only will breed more of the same. Violence begets more violence. But listen, you know, we've got a few minutes still to go, and I really want to concentrate. This is I respect you so much for this message to come out. I want to also, as a female filmmaker here, and this is a very male-dominated world, right? So they approach you, approach them, and you were welcomed into a discussion with them. And tell us a little about your plans for this film. I know it's going to be there's going to be an event on the.
We are holding an event on February 28th. It's going to be a panel discussion in which the Nature Carter rabbis who are featured in the film are going to be in conversation with
in
local
person.
Palestinian scholars and activists here in New York City at the People's Forum, 7 p.m. on February 28th. So people should feel free to.
That's on 37th Street? We could look that up.
Sure,
yeah, people. Okay, so the People's Forum at 7 o'clock on February 28th. So you will actually have a chance to talk with some of the rabbis and some of the Palestinian
and Palestinian scholars and activists will be in conversation with them, and people can learn more about Naturei Karta, about the film. We'll be screening clips from the film, and celebrating with food and music, and it should be a fun time.
I'm going to try to make of that. And so what have you learned doing this film, you personally?
That filmmaking is very hard work.
I bet.
And I guess I've learned a lot actually about Naturei Karta, about their theology, about their history, about the history of Palestine, about the strength and resilience of the Palestinian people, and about the courage that it takes to resist violence,
And yourself as a human being, and as a Jew, what have you learned about that background or heritage or that part of yourself? What have you brought out of that experience?
Yeah, I mean, I think that learning about this movement has been this religious movement for social justice has been very eye-opening and inspiring in many ways, because we often hear about social justice movements being led by secular folks, and I think that it's also important to be aware that religious people also can support social justice, and do support social justice movements.
But you, as a woman, do you feel strengthened in some way with your Jewishness or not? Or taking a second look?
I feel strengthened in knowing that there's people standing up for justice, and that they're, mm-hmm. that they're, that the stance that they're taking is ethically rooted, morally rooted, and okay. that it's based in their understanding of the Torah and Jewish history and what it means to be Jewish. I think that there's a lot of strength in knowing that.
Knowing that for yourself, I see. Interesting. And we could go on and on, but the last couple of minutes, should talk about this more, but your viewpoint of the rabbis toward women and gays and transgender and so on, mm-hmm. homosexuality and rights of women, and we can go on the right to be divorced and so on. Where does that enter into your consciousness, or is that something that's secondary to what you've been exploring here?
I think it's, you know, important to talk about, you know, the rabbis are a socially conservative group of people with conservative values on some issues, including sexuality and gender.
You agree with most? You as a woman?
Do I agree with?
Well, do you feel comfortable with those sorts of, that their understanding?
You know, there are ways in which I agree with some of, you know, as I relate to most humans, I think that there are things that they believe that I agree with, and there are things that they believe that I disagree with, and I imagine that they probably, you know, I feel that way about most people that I get to know.
Heather,
they're complicated.
It is complicated, but thank you for
thank you so much for having me.
Unraveling the complexity. I think it's been clear. I really respect what you've tried to do here.
Thank you.
And we'll see you on the 28th. I want to go see that, and
thank
everybody
you.
Else. Come join us.
Yes, please.
The People's Forum.
People's Forum.
People's Forum.
Thank you.
7 o'clock on the 28th.
Thank you.
The renowned psychiatrist Robert J. Lifton warned of zealots who felt it was necessary to destroy the world in order to save it. These true believers included Adolf Hitler, who believed in a never-ending race war that would purify the earth and cleanse the world of inferior, evil, and foreign peoples, as he and Nazi ideology defined them. Over 60 million people died as a result of that mentality during World War II. Psychiatrist James Gilligan has pointed out that the main institutions we have invented to prevent or at least minimize human violence have been morality and religion. But the most deadly violence has always been committed in the name of morality and religion. If we've learned anything from human history, it's that to finally end the never-ending cycle of violence, we need to develop forms of religious experience and expression that are mature and psychologically healthy. We need a response of radical love, healing, redemption, and equal justice for all, a fusion coalition politics of caring and nurturing, representing all people in any place throughout the globalized world. It's a life-affirming agape love, a transpersonal universal concern with care and respect for all humans, not punitive, violent, hypocritical, or applying double standards. In reality, it's the only alternative we have to the destructive and self-destructive cycle of a fundamentalist, retributive, fear-based worldview of violence that continues to bedevil the human condition and threatens the extension of all of us as a species. Progressives need and must do better to understand this, and we all do. Let's close with a beautiful song of peace, Havanah, Shalom Aleichem. This is Jim Vrettos. See you next week on The Radical Imagination. And thank you so very much again, Heather Tenzer.
Shalom. Shalom.